Okay, so last class we're looking at the cache coherency protocols, and we had discussed about the Snoopy protocol and how it can be implemented, the different actions that the cache controller has to take based on the requests either from the local processor or on the bus and things like that. Now let's continue with our discussion and look at how the cache coherency can be achieved in case of a non-uniform memory access protocol, a non-uniform memory access computer, right? Now we had just discussed about a non-uniform memory access computer, how the nodes have their memory IO, and then they have their communicate on an interconnection network, and the messages have long latency. Implementing broadcast is very inefficient because these are mostly point-to-point messaging. And had said that in a directory-based solution, we have to keep track of all the processors who are trying to use a page, right? The cached copies of specific memory locations. We'll have to keep track of that. And on a write onto one of the pages, we only need to inform the users, exactly those who are using it, and need not broadcast it because that would be inefficient. And on reading a dirty block, we'll have to get it from the owner and forward it to the one that is needing it. And then we were talking of the shared virtual memory implemented in DSMs. We said that shared virtual memory is often provided, even though it might be an inefficient solution, but it is often provided because it is easy to use. It is a great convenience to the programmers. And then we had said that the pages are unit of sharing and pages are unit of coherence. And we had discussed about how it might work. It said that read-only pages are not a problem at all, can be replicated. Only when a processor wants to write, somehow it should talk to operating system on a write, and then the operating system should initiate the necessary actions. And we had said that fault sharing can be increased, and let's see how it can be implemented. So here a page can be in either of the three states. It is a shared when one or more processors have data and the memory is up to date. So the data that is available or the page that is available with the processors and that available in the memory is up to date. Only thing is that the memory controller will have to keep track of who are having the data, which processors are having it in shared state. And when the data is uncached, then no processor has block, right? In uncached state and exclusive state, one processor has the block, right? In addition to the cache state, we must track which processors are using it, and normally to implement it, we will or an efficient implementation will be a bit vector rather than representing the address for each node, etc. We just have corresponding to each node, we just have one bit. If the bit is set, then the node has it. Otherwise, if it is zero, it doesn't have it. Okay? That way, that may be an efficient implementation. Now let's look at the directory behavior. On a read request, if it is unused, then it gives the copy to the requester and record who is having it. And if it is in exclusive or shared state, then send a share message to the current exclusive owner and add the new owner to the list of the owners and then return the value to the owner. Is that okay? So send a message to the current exclusive owner. So the current exclusive owner will have to update that, isn't it? We'll have to update the data that is available in the memory, and the new owner who is requesting a exclusive or shared access have to record it, forward it, the data to him, that is return the value to him. Okay. Now if it is exclusive and dirty, we'll have to forward the read request to the exclusive owner, and then the data has to be forwarded. On a write, we send invalidate, we need to send invalidate message to all hosts caching the values. On a write through or write back, we'll have to update the value. Now to understand it fully, let's see the specific actions on specific requests. Here, as we are saying that the memory controller will have the necessary information about each page, and that's why we can't really distinguish between a local and a remote access, right? So we'll draw it on one diagram. There we could nicely say that, see, one FSM corresponds to local access, another for data on the bus, and so on. Here we have all coming on the bus, because this data is maintained at the memory controller, right? So let's see, here we are saying that invalid, shared and exclusive. In invalid, on a CPU write, send write miss message to the hard disk, okay? So if it is it's invalid and there is a CPU write, then we'll have to send the write miss message to the hard disk. And if it is in the exclusive and there is a fetch or invalidate, then write back message to the home directory. And if it is exclusive and there is a read hit or write hit, don't do anything. And if it is an exclusive and there is a fetch request, send the data write back message to home directory. Okay, so actually let me just clarify a little bit here. See, here we are saying that the action that the local processor will have to take, it's not the memory controller. Just see here that the fetch request is actually sent by the memory controller or the directory, right? So this is the local node, the action that it has to do, it's not with the memory controller. So here if it is invalid and there is a CPU read, it sends read miss message and the controller will handle that. And if it is in shared state, then it sends an invalidate and there is an invalidate request coming in, or there is a miss due to address conflict, it just makes it invalid, right? The invalidate request might be generated by the memory controller. Okay, if it is shared and there is a CPU read, the local one, then it just keeps there and so on. So this is a much simpler diagram than the other one, and that's why I will not spend more time here. So in each state, invalid, shared and exclusive, we are just mentioning the requests that the processor might get, either due to a local request or a request from the memory controller. No processor directly requests to another processor, unlike a Snoopy, right? It's via the memory controller. So all these are either the local node generates this, or it is from a request from a memory controller to fetch. Is that okay? So it is already holding an exclusive and the memory controller sends a fetch. When does it have to send a fetch? Anyone wants to answer this question? See, a processor, a node is having it in exclusive state and a fetch request is generated. Yes? When will the fetch request be generated? Anybody wants to answer this question? Why don't you come prepared little bit? Right, I can see that no one is answering this question. When will be FH generated by the memory controller? The fetch will be generated by the memory controller when one node is having it in exclusive state, okay, and another node is either trying to write or read. So it has to get the data and then send it. Okay, so the fetch message will send by the memory controller when there is a request from another node processor. So here this one was the CPU state machine. This is the state machine maintained at the CPU. We can do a similar thing for the directory. The directory, as well, you were saying that it tracks all memory block, the same state as the transition diagram for an individual case. So where three states will be there for each block, isn't it? The memory controller actions can be to update the memory, update the directory state and send messages to satisfy the request, such as fetch. And it indicates the action by the sharing set. We'll have a sharing set or sharers which will say who are having the data, which nodes will have the data. This is what the directory will maintain. So this is the state machine. So we'll have two things here. One is with the memory controller. There are two components of this protocol. Actually, even if you think of the other protocol, there are two components. Here, there are two components. One is the actions to maintain coherency by the memory controller, generate some things. And the other part of the protocol is running with the nodes. Local nodes, they will have to also do certain things based on specific requests, and they need to have a circuitry, a controller to do that, and on the memory controller also we need a circuitry. But the thing to notice here is that the sharers or who are having a copy is available with the directory, not with the other nodes. So here, let's see how it works. This cache can be in three state, uncached, shared, and exclusive. Whereas on the other side, that is on the side of the nodes, we had found that the three states are invalid, shared, and exclusive. Is that okay? Okay. So here, if the directory says it, the directory state of the page is uncached and there is a read miss generated by a certain processor P, then it just keeps track of who has requested. It makes the sharer set is equal to P and sends the data value in reply. Simple, isn't it? Now, if there is a read miss by another one, another processor wants the same data, it does the same thing. It sends the data value and just increments the sharer set. It adds the ID of the requesting node to the sharer set and keeps in the same state. Now, if there is a write miss generated by one of the processor, it has to send an invalidate request to all those who are holding it, invalidate all the share. So it generates a specific request for all those who are in the sharer set, and then it initializes the sharer set to the one who has generated the write miss. Okay, and then it sends the data value as a reply message. Okay, if it is in the exclusive state and then another node generates read miss, it has to just increase the sharer set and then it has to fetch the data from the one that is currently having exclusive ownership, and then it sends the data value to the one that is requesting. Is that okay? Similarly, when it gets a write miss it does similar thing, excepting that it invalidates, fetches and then invalidates. And if it gets a data write back request from one of the nodes, then it just initializes the server set to null. So some processor has replaced it block. It just written data back. It's written data.
On the shared state, there is a write miss.
Shared state, yes, there is a write miss. Yes, yes.
Then same data value. Why from the data expansion?
Where here? Write miss, send data value. See the one, see here, just see that you don't broadcast, right? So any node that requests to read, you will have to send the data. It will not get unless you send it. So one node has requested a write miss, and you will invalidate to the servers and initialize the server set to P and then send the page to it for writing.
From whom?
Send from the memory, isn't it? The memory controller will send the page. See, somebody has generated, some node has generated a write miss.
But the state was in shared.
State was in shared. Some nodes were having it in the shared state. Okay. So once somebody is requesting a write, you will have to invalidate the servers, isn't it? And then the one that is requesting the write, you will have to make it the server. Only one node is having now, right? And that node, you will have to send the page.
It's like the same for that protocol. It has to have the extra memory access.
No, here we are sending it from the memory controller, right? From the memory we are sending it, but from there another processor could just send it. We are saying about memory access and things like that, if you look at it. Here, we will have to send it. Unless we send, it will not get. Any other difficulty here? Simple thing, if you think of it, very simple, looks complicated, efficient. But you just analyze each action. Each action is just intuitive. Even without reading this, you can write the FSM if you understand the protocol. Anyone has difficulty with this? So just where, just let me, since some are looking confused, let me just say that for implementing the directory-based protocol, we have to have two controls. One with the local nodes and the other with the memory controller. The local node, the controller with the local node will have to look at the requests generated by the local node and also the coherency requests generated by the memory controller or the directory, right? And then do specific actions. This is the one that the controller with each node will have to implement this, okay? And then there is also another controller with the memory, which implements, which keeps the directory of who is accessing, that is the server set. And also, as the different nodes generate different activities, read miss, write miss, data write back, and so on, it takes specific actions in terms of incrementing the server set or initializing the server set, and so on, and then generating specific requests for specific nodes and supplying data. Simple thing, and somehow you are not coming prepared to the class, otherwise should be able to ask questions. No one is either asking question nor is able to answer questions. Now let's look at an example. So here we are considering a non-uniform memory access computer. And we are, for simplicity, we are considering a two-node non-uniform memory access computer written node 1, node 2, processor 1, processor 2, and there is an interconnection network, and then in the memory there is a directory. There is a directory, and then there is memory which is having specific values, right? Now let's say P1 wants to write 10 to some address A1, and A1 and A2 map to the same. Okay, instead of cache block, maybe you will write page, that may be more. It can be a cache block if the sharing is at the block level. But we said that a page level would be more user friendly, programmer friendly. So let's assume that P1 writes 10 to A1. So here, a write miss will be generated on the interconnect network, right? The P1 would, because P1 did not have it, right, for specific block A1, P1 will generate a write miss, and then it will have it in exclusive state, and then the data reply P1 A1 with zero value, and the sharer set on the directory will be P1. Is that okay? Simple thing. The write miss generated by the node because it did not have the page or the block, and then it makes it in the exclusive state and writes it, but before that there is a data reply from the controller. Initial value was zero, and the directory is having P1 as the only sharer. And now let's say P1 wants to read A1. So since it is already having it in the exclusive state, the local controller does not request the memory. Is that okay? Now if P2 wants to read A1, so it will generate a read miss. And after read miss, it has to be, data has to be written back. The sharer will be A1, and now sharer has to be incremented to P1 and P2, right? P1, sorry, this is a state at the P1, statement end at P1 is shared, it will continue to be, the state maintained at P2 will become shared, and that at P1 will become shared. From exclusive, it will become shared. It will have to write back the data, right? So even though we have written fetch, actually it is write back, because we are trying to combine these two actions. Actually, they are two separate actions. Fetch is the one sent by the memory controller, and in response to that, the one holding it in exclusive state, that is P1, writes the data, updates the memory, write back. But just to make the example shorter, just combined into a single one. And then the processor 2 has it in shared state, A1 with value 10, and before that it has got a data reply from the memory controller with 10, and the sharer set is incremented to P1, P2, right? Now, what if there is a write of 20 to A1? So there is a write miss generated, and the state is changed to exclusive, and 20 is written, and then invalidation is sent to P1, and P1 converts its state to invalid, and the directory, the sharer set is changed to P2. Okay, and even though 20 is written here, just see that it is not updated, because it is having it in exclusive dirty. Now what if P2 writes 40 to A2, and A2 is a different block, but it is conflicting with A1. They map to the same page or the same cache block. So here again, it checks, wants to write A2, 40 to A2, finds that A2 is not present, A1 is present, that's why it will generate a write miss. Write miss, P2 generates a write miss for A2, and then the directory, it changes the A2 address to, the sharer set for A2 is P2, and it will generate a write back from P2 with 20, and it will be updated, 20 will be updated here, and the state will be exclusive, and there will be a data reply with a 0, and the server will be P2 and the value will be 0. On cast, it's not visible here. The state is uncast. It was not there available with anyone.
Sir, when write 20 to A1 instruction is there?
Just which step?
Go to the leftmost column.
Right.
20 to A1.
Write 20 to A1, yes.
Why didn't say read means, write means? The data was already available with A1.
No, see, the state was saved. Okay, it was in a saved state, and therefore it will have to generate a write miss saying that, see, those who already have it in saved state, they should be invalidated. And A2 and A1 are different blocks, that's why all these actions have taken place. If it was same block, then nothing would have happened. So given a state at which a block or a page is held on a node and the server set at the directory for a specific request by any node, you should be able to tell what are the actions that will occur, and that by the different processors on the bus and the directory and the value and the memory. Which step? You just tell me which request. Write 20 to A1. Okay, please look at those who have not understood. Please look at this one. So, see that A1 was being held in shared state by P1 and also shared state by P2. And at that moment, P2 is generating a write to A1, write 20 to A1. So, since the state was shared, if you look at the FSM at the local node, you will see that when there is a write request coming, when it is in shared state, it will generate a write miss. P2 is generating a write miss for A1.
I'm not getting voice because the data is already available.
Data is already available, but if it writes, the data will become inconsistent with that with P1. If it writes 20, then P1 will have 10, it will have 20.
No, the invalid command will be there, but why the write miss?
That's the way of generating the invalidate command. Only when that you generate a write miss, one node wants exclusive access, it indicates, a write miss indicates that one node wants exclusive access to that page or block, and the ones that are already having should be invalidated. Is that okay? Since the state was already shared, we are not really supplying the data again. Otherwise, we will have to do a data reply. If it did not have it, let's say P2 did not have it, then we will have to do a data reply. Here we are avoiding the data reply because it's already there with it in shared state.
But sir, why we require data reply in write state?
Yeah, see, you are updating only one value, but a page has several values. One page consists of large number of values. So if you are writing only one value there, what about the other values? What will that have? Is that clear to everybody? The question that he is asking, that on a write miss, why do you have to supply the data? Because anyway it is going to update it. I thought that many of you would know it already, that when you write only one address, and there are several addresses on the page or the block. What about those values? Where will you get it? Next time you replace it, which one will you write? Is that okay? Are you convinced? Yes, yes or no? Is everybody convinced? Anyone not convinced? Okay, so everybody is convinced. That's good. So we just looked at an example about how the directory-based protocol will work for a specific example. Yeah. it is uncached. Unfortunately, the example is large and the letters have not come. Only partly U, partly has come. It is in the uncached state. Okay. Actually, I wanted to increase the letter because it should be visible, and when we make it visible, only part of that is coming. Now, let's look at the implementation of a directory-based protocol. When the number of processors are large, then the directory will become large because we are maintaining one bit for every processor, for every page or every block. The directory size will become very large as the number of processors increase. And also, the access to the directory will become a bottleneck, because various processors will require actions. And for as the number of processors increase, we'll have to distribute the directory among different memory modules. So even though we saw a very simple case where we had only one directory, but when we're considering of a large non-uniform memory access computer, we'll have to bring additional complexities. Like which request will be handled by which directory, multiple directories, and so on. But let's not complicate the matter any further, but let's just remember that for larger non-uniform memory access computers, we'll have to distribute the directories to overcome the bottleneck of a single directory. Now let's look at another issue with SMPs, even to some extent in the non-uniform memory access computer, but let's consider the SMPs now. The multiprocessor, the basic programming support that has to be provided in a SMP. So one key programming support that every SMP has to provide is synchronization. In fact, any computer would have to provide a synchronization, some way to synchronize. But why do you need synchronization? Can anybody say, see, you have studied about synchronization in various contexts in operating system and things like that, but why does any process or anything need to synchronize? And anyone else wants to answer this question? Why do you need to synchronize? See, this is another question frequently asked in your vivas, in even when you go to a company interview or something, they will ask this question. If it is a company with doing technical work, right, with operating systems and things like that, very simple question. So, the question that we normally ask in your vivas: what is synchronization? What would happen if we don't synchronize? How do we implement synchronization? And we find that very funny answers given by many students, large number of students. We specifically ask, can you implement synchronization by using a variable in a program? Like, let's say we have a C program. Can you write a synchronization primitive by using a integer or something to keep track of the status? And people start with saying semaphores and things like that. So can semaphore be integer? Things like that. So what is your opinion? Why do you need to synchronize? So he just said that, see, when different processes need to share the data, you need to synchronize and somehow let only the safe situations. If one process can safely access, you synchronize and allow only one. If there are two safe to access, you allow only those two, things like that. So it lets different processes use shared data when it is safe for them to access. And he said, otherwise it will become inconsistent. And we then ask you about, give an example how it will become inconsistent, and see that many of you are just struggling to come up with an example. I don't know why. But okay, now how do you implement a synchronization primitive? Can you just write a C function to synchronize different processes?
It's atomic.
Okay, but atomic, all instructions are atomic.
Yeah,
If you think of a processor, can you tell me one instruction which is not atomic? Load, store, increment. Because the processor doesn't save the state of an instruction and it is halfway. So it either completes or does not complete. All instructions are atomic. Okay. Okay. So those, see, even this much many don't answer. See, it's not just an atomic instruction. All instructions are atomic. See, what you need atomic is to fetch and update in the same instruction. You need, say, normally fetch and update are two separate instructions. In a normal computer, you need to fetch and update in a single atomic operation. So that's the basic support that needs to be provided by a uniprocessor. But okay, before we look at how it is done in a multiprocessor, let's see the objective of any synchronization algorithm. It should reduce the latency, or in other words, the overhead of maintaining the synchronization should be least. How quickly an application can get a lock. It should reduce the waiting time. Unnecessary waiting by processor should be avoided. It should reduce the contention so that the different processes can easily get the lock. And if you think of the traditional computers, you will see that there are various types of synchronization primitives provided by different manufacturers. Some provide, but all basically involve a read, modify and then write. Read value, modify that value and then write is the basic atomic operation that all processors need to support. And that comes in various flavors depending on the manufacturer of the processor. It can be test and set, it can be fetch and store, it can be fetch and add, it can be compare and swap, things like that. So these are with respect to a traditional uniprocessor computer. So for example, in an atomic exchange, we interchange the value in a register for a value in memory. So the processor will have one value in the register, and then it gets the value in the specific location in the memory and stores the value that is there in its register in a single atomic operation. This is also quite popular nowadays, right, in uniprocessors and atomic exchange. And if it finds that its register after atomic exchange has zero, then it is available. If it is one, somebody has locked it. So to set the lock, it sets its register to 1 and then swaps. If it finds that 0 has come back after swapping, finds that it is available, it remains 1, then knows that somebody is using. So basic atomic exchange operation, right? And once such an operation is available, atomic exchange, then you can implement test and set, fetch and increment and so on. So just think about it, how to implement, we will not spend time on it. Now let's look at the synchronization issue in multiprocessors. If you think of it, a fetch and update operation, even though it can be implemented in a multiprocessor, will be highly inefficient. None of the SMPs that you will look support a fetch and update directly. The problem here, there are many problems here. One of the problem is a coherent cache. So as one processor fetches and updates, the other processors might generate a fetch and update, and as a result it will be invalidated. Each time a fetch and update is executed by one of the processor, it will be invalidated and there will be too much of memory traffic, right? And also, just see here, fetch and update, until it completes, the other processors would just stall, right? Just think about it. I request you, I am not spending time here, but I request you to investigate why traditional atomic fetch and update operations are inefficient in an SMP. please investigate. And we'll see that in SMPs, if you use fetch and update and things like that, it will be highly inefficient, will become a bottleneck. It will reduce the efficiency of the SMPs, and as I was saying, none of the commercial SMPs use this kind of operations. So before we look at synchronization in SMPs, we'll talk about the different locks, and we'll also discuss about a barrier. In a programming involving multiple processes, running on multiple processors, we might have to implement a barrier also. A barrier is one that is a synchronization point for various processors. Just consider that your, let's say, monitoring temperature in a terrain, over a large area, you are monitoring temperature. And you want the temperature to be recorded by various sensors precisely at the same time, okay? Or maybe it is a nuclear power plant, and the different sensors have to do it at the precise time, or the action at different places have to be taken at the same time. Several examples exist where the processors have to start doing something at the same time, but they might take different times, and then again when they start the next cycle, they should start exactly at the same time, right? That's a barrier. So we'll see how a synchronization algorithm can be used to implement a barrier, and that too efficiently. Now let's look at the synchronization primitives that are being used in the SMPs and how they are efficient compared to fetch and update, how they have been optimized and things like that, that let's look at. So an atomic exchange, as we are discussing, is very inefficient to have both read and write in the same instruction, and as we will see that here we don't have an atomic instruction. That concept of having an atomic exchange, we actually have two separate instructions here in the SMPs. So the two separate instructions are called as load linked and store conditional, LL and SC. The load linked, once a processor issues it, it will return the value that is available, okay? And the store conditional, so first it finds out what is the value currently it is there, is it 0 or 1? And if it is a 0, then it tries to store a 1. And if it succeeds in storing, then it will return a 1, otherwise return a 0. So please understand this, that to make it efficient, we split the atomic exchange operation into two separate instructions. One instruction is called as load linked, and this is issued sometime later, maybe immediately or maybe sometime later, by a store conditional. So if you find that there is a 0, see the problem with this one atomic exchange is that we are trying to read and write. This will cause too many invalidations. Whenever you know that there is a write request, it will cause invalidations. Whereas here, we are first reading it, and then if we find that it is unused, it's available, then only we try to do a write. And the problem here that has to be tracked is, several processes might have read at the same time, and then several of them might try to store, and one of them will succeed, right? So some might fail because either after it has read, somebody else has already written, and things like that. So the store conditional may not succeed always. If it succeeds, you will see a 1 in your register. If it has failed, you will find a 0. So the register indicates success in getting lock, as you are saying. A 0 indicates that the lock has been set, and 1 if somebody has already claimed access. But here even though we have two separate registers, sorry, two separate instructions, the main idea is to somehow make them operate indivisibly. Confusing, is it? Okay, just proceed with, let us proceed and it will become clear. Unless it is clear, we will take an example and explain. So, even though they are separate instructions, LL and SC are separate instructions, they execute effectively atomically. So, that means LL and SC, as if they have been executed and none other processors has in between tried to do something with the same lock value, right? The same lock, none of the processors had done anything. Then it will be effectively atomic. So it is equivalent if the load and store had completed atomically, but even though we are having separate instruction, but the benefit is that now it is much more efficient. We don't generate invalidations and things like that. Only when we find that the lock is available, we try to write. Later we will quantitatively see what would be the benefit or to what extent. But the thing is that we will be succeeding in locking it if no other processor has stored to the same location. If some other processor stores to the location, then we will get a failure. And also, what if the processor that had generated the LL, before it could generate the SC, has a context switch? And much after generates the SC, what will happen? Or let's say the second process which just woke up, which context switched and generates the SC to the same location, should it succeed? No. So even context switches, etc., has to be kept track, interrupts, and if any of these conditions are there, that some other processor is trying to write, has written there, no context switch has occurred, interrupts, etc., has occurred, then only we should assume that the LLSC has successfully executed. Otherwise, we should say that the lock is not available. But how do we implement this? How do we keep track of no other processor has written, no context switch has occurred, no interrupt has occurred? That is implemented by maintaining a link register. This is a register invisible to the programmer. But whenever you use a LL to some location, some things will be stored in LL. Let's see what will be stored. It will store the address of the instruction doing the LL. Just see here. This will store which instruction is doing LL. And it will be invalidate if any other instruction does SC. So, you might have been doing LL at some location and then doing SC in some other process. So, this will be invalidate, and also the link register will be invalidated when there is a process switch. But we said that LL and SC are executed one after other, and few other instructions might be put in between LL and SC, and there should not be too much of separation. Now, let us see what are the exact restrictions here. Care must be taken about which instructions can be placed between the LLSC pair. So, we can have few register instructions only. Otherwise, it is possible to have a starvation situation where an SC instruction will never be successful. So, can anybody explain this? Why is it that only register instructions are allowed, and why would it lead to a starvation situation? Can anybody explain this? Why only register instructions, and that too few of them? And why will there be a starvation? Okay, since no one is forthcoming, let me just explain that. See, here the thing is that if there is a there are many instructions between LL and LS, even if there are many register instructions, there might be a context switch, there is a high chance of context switch occurring between LL and SC if there are too many register instructions, right? And if there is a context switch, the LLSC will not succeed. So each time it does a LLSC, it finds that lock is not available, again comes and does a LLSC. So it just keeps on doing LLSC without really making progress. It's trying to get the lock without getting lock, and as a result the process will not proceed and it will lead to a starvation. But what about only few register instructions? Why not memory instructions? Because the same problem, memory instructions take long time and in between there can be context switch. You know from operating system course that if there is a page fault, when there is a read write and there is a page fault, then it will lead to a context switch. Every operating system does a context switch when there is a page fault, right? So a read and write can lead to context switch. Read and write to memory can lead to context switch, and also read and write take long time, there are chances of context switch anyway. So in a SMP, the synchronization primitive is LL and SC, and these even the separate instructions operate as if they are atomic together, but to use it you will have to take certain precautions, only small number of registers and without any memory accesses. So we will look at how to get other synchronization primitives using LLSC, we will look at the concept of a spin lock and where you would need a spin lock, how it will be implemented, and then we will look at how you can implement a barrier using this, right? So that we will do the next class. Stop here. So we'll meet on Thursday at 7:30. 7:30.